Hi, good morning. To give you a big, quick background from where Anand left off, we are part of Excel before Anand was. So when we started towards the late 2007 and early 2008, CommonFlow started as a product targeting homeowners to come together on a common platform, discuss their issues, and solve together. It was sort of a pre-internet era, what we can call as. Internet was a place you go to, so people had to go to internet. No longer that is the case. And when we were looking for raising funds, and in fact, Excel was not Excel at that point of time. Excel was Erasmic when they were talking to us. Once they had raised the money and became Excel, Flipkart and CommonFlow are the first two companies that they have invested in. So that's the backstory on how we connect with Excel. It's been a fantastic journey. I've been into entrepreneurship close to 9 years. Total industry experience about a decade. Unfortunately, when I joined professional world, I was told the way to progress in life is you code, then you write Word documents, then you write PPTs, then you write Excels, and then you write emails, right? And unfortunately for me, I jumped from writing code to writing emails. So pardon me for the slides. The whole idea I would try to communicate across during the 20 minutes, odd minutes I have, is how we went about doing things, what we learned. And when we started, we were about 23-year-old guys. It was stupid, crazy thing. If you did not have gray hair, no one funded you. The things have completely, the world has come around in next last 7 years. It's other way now. If you have gray hairs, you are unfundable. In Hindi, there is a term, dunya golmaal hai. No one knows what the hell is happening, right? So that's the exact case scenario. But yeah, I would agree that the younger founders generally have an unfair advantage. In my case, when I started out, the biggest fear, the reason I quit the job and started off was, if I don't, I have to get married, right? Yeah, now that I'm married, it's the other way around. So if I actually quit, that because I'm married, I'm going to get killed, right? So it's life changes, very difficulty, different things. Today, what I'm going to talk about is scale. About my learnings, simply put across. So what I'm going to talk about is three things. On the scale side, when do you scale, what do you scale, and how do you scale? Scale is something that everyone talks about. Hardly most people understand what the hell that means. And specifically, that is one area of the lifetime of the company, or the initial lifetime of the company, where all hell breaks loose. So when do you scale is very, very important. A lot of companies fail because of premature scaling. Really good companies, really good teams, but fail because they prematurely scale. What to scale is also very important, and how do you go about it, or at least our learnings on how we actually went about it. So my personal learning is, when do you scale? I will give you an example. How do we go about it? So in the initial first 3-4 months, we had a small product, a few basic features. We went across to every apartment that was nearby in Sarjapur, and quickly iterated and asked questions to all our customers, or users, or possible users, on a daily basis, exactly what they wanted to do. So on a very quick level, we kept iterating. So some features which we thought was important but were not giving results, we killed them. Once we actually got some traction to certain things, we started marketing that better, selling that to the next guys. Quickly iterating on a daily basis, going to the market, taking the feedback, again, correcting yourself, really helped us to build scale, specifically in the market. So for us, one of the bigger challenges in the very early days was, one, we were trying to sell to a consumer base or a market which was not yet ready for internet itself, forget the product. Second, we were talking about a product that was not even heard across the globe. We are India's, in fact, world's largest single complete residential platform, which helps you right from helping to find a house, rent, buy, to move in, to help you connect with your neighbors and run the entire society. So we were talking about something that was alien even from the perspective of Western world. So it was even more difficult for us because there was no nobody to copy from or look to. So we had to quickly iterate and figure out what we were trying to do. So in the first initial 3 years, what we did was to go out there, build communities. And we had a lot of challenges which we turned into opportunities. For example, 2008 is when Google launched the Map Maker. So I am also talking about pre-map era. We did not have the data online. We did not have the map data, geospatial data. We did not have a directory of knowing where our apartments were. So personally, I went out about visiting every single apartment that was standing in Bangalore, traveled about 25,000 odd kilometers on my bike in Bangalore city in the first 3 years, and converted the challenge into an opportunity where we are the largest source of geolocated apartment data in the country today. So what we did, so once I figured that out, how do we go about getting this information, which was very critical and the missing piece in the entire online property world, we replicated the same model to other cities. So the first iteration was me myself trying it out completely, and then once we very clearly knew what exactly was working for us, we went out and scaled that. Over the period of time, we applied the same things, quickly iterate on certain processes, we will figure it out. Once we figured that out, the second important thing came in place was process and infrastructure, right? So if we wanted to scale, if we did not have the right processes, so what I did myself was also a lot of using the brain every iteration. But you cannot expect, when you try to scale something, you cannot expect the same exact thing from the people that you get on board, because scaling requires minimal new thoughts. Specifically, it is more about you already know the direction you are driving on a road, and if there are road humps, etc., you can try to avoid, brake, etc. But the direction has to be set, and for that you have to have a map, and that's where you have to define the process and get the infrastructure in place. So if you don't have that and you decide, okay, I'm going to scale today, and you start spending on marketing, you are definitely going to fail. Or you decide, I will hire 50 people at a go, but you do not have a process which ensures that you are not part of that equation. If you don't have that built before you try to scale, again you will fail. So before you start thinking about, a very important thing is you have some process or infrastructure in place to actually start the scaling of that particular thing that you think is going to take you to the next step. Over the period of time, another thing what we realized is, while we are scaling things, a lot of things we tried failed. Only those things where we found the next successive milestone that we set for ourselves becoming easier, or rather I would say becoming mildly harder than the previous one, were the things that actually scaled. So when we observed that certain particular, for example, when we first went into real estate market, and this is after about 3 years of our existence and building a community base, we sold supply leads to the brokers in a very on-demand and pull format, which still doesn't exist in the market. So what I mean is, as a broker, you can get demand generation anywhere. You put out those small printed note cards on a tree, and you will get someone who is looking for a house. That's how easy it is. Because the demand is outstripping the supply, like 80-1 in certain cases. So broker was easily able to get demand from anywhere at that point of time. What the biggest challenge was, they did not get an access to the house owner. And it was a limiting factor to their business. So when we entered into real estate, we actually went in with this particular hypothesis that broker will need to get supply to increase his business. In the initial few brokers we signed up, we had smaller checks. We said if we can ask for a larger amount of money to the next customer, we at least are on the right track. So in about next 6 months, we became the largest guy in the broker space in Bangalore. So we clearly knew that we had something that we could scale. So there is a business possibility in online real estate, which is becoming mildly harder after every milestone for us. So we should go and pivot from our offline hyperlocal play to an online real estate play at this point of time. So that is when we decided to scale real estate and literally shut down a business model which was breaking even for us. So we reached a break-even point and decided to shut down that business model and pivot to an online real estate player. There are also some apparent scale saturation points. We started with that particular problem saying that we'll become the largest guy in the broker space. We became the largest guy. There is a scale saturation point there. That point is, I cannot get all the supply online because the entire market is so fragmented. About 30% of investors are not even in Bangalore. They are not reachable. There are people who don't even want to be known that they are investors there. So there are scale saturation points in this particular problem. So if we had to keep selling supply only, we would never have grown to what we have grown to. So we decided that, okay, this is a particular, we will reach a particular level of scale. And so this become our entry strategy instead of our scale and large scale business strategy. So we took this as an entry strategy wherever we went and said, boss, we are the only ones who can provide you this. Come on board. While you are doing this, by the way, you also need to generate demand. On the demand side, that was very elastic because demand was outstripping supply many a times, right? Multiples of the factor. So this scale saturation points also has to be identified to a certain extent. Sometimes it's not very obvious. When you start putting your revenue projections in place, suddenly you start realizing that this, the product that you are generating, you will not be able to produce enough. So that's where we again did a little pivot from just selling supply to the brokers, which became our entry strategy, and becoming the entire marketplace and also helping them generate very relevant demand. So this is the whens of when we decided to do sudden scaling and why we decided that. So very importantly, what my learning has been through this, that what you scale becomes also very, very important and crucial. Most people think marketing only is scaling, right? I disagree with that. Marketing is part of probably one of these at different stages at a different scale. But these are the fundamentally four things that you have to scale. You have to first scale self. So specifically when I'm talking about us, we had no prior experience. We had not seen the world, and we did not know what we did not know. So first and foremost, what we did was we went to a lot of people. So some of the guys like Sameer here was one of our early helpers and well-wishers. So we went to them and asked, how do you do this? What do you do about this? And where should I get an answer to that? Scaling self is the most important thing, specifically when you're going to scale a business. And the hardest thing to do because you have to change every single day. Every few months, you become a roadblock to your own company. The biggest reason the companies fail because founders themselves are not able to scale fast enough to take the company to the next level. So we had to relearn, unlearn. We had to go to every single source, talk to every single customer. Anywhere we thought we can get help, we went to. We had to articulate and write down the challenges and the problems that we felt was very important. For example, we never knew how to hire at scale. What kind of processes you might need at hiring. How to market. What does it take to actually crack SEM? How does you crack SEO? So how do you build a technology stack, which specifically becomes important when you are bringing in teams? So with all of these things, either we went to the books, we went to the blogs, and in most cases, we went to our peers in Flipkart, peers in few other companies like Myntra, or some of the guys who have at least seen larger organizations, or the very small experience that we had. So I worked for SAP Labs for about a year before I started Common Floor, referring to that. So scaling self was the most important thing to be able to scale the entire organization. Then product and technology, a lot of questions are very, very relevant. What technology to use, what stack to work on, how do you actually have a product definition thing in place, how are you taking care of your customer support, are these things well thought through, is your MVP really an MVP? A lot of people think MVP means having something and just sending it across, right? And that becomes your MVP. And it's not really that. The MVP actually is having one use case of your customer solved end to end. The customer might need 10 different things, but if one single simple use case which can be completely solved because of your product, that is a good of MVP to start with. If you are not able to solve that one single use case end to end, probably that's not an MVP. So that was very important thing that we realized during the early iterations of a product technology. So you have to start focusing on how you will be able to grow to a large product and technology team, and what are the right choices that you need to make, because these choices are very, very painful going later on. And we made some of those mistakes. Then coming to operations. Operations also are very, very key area where you will, specifically in Indian context, and if you're a consumer company in India, a lot of information is completely missing in the ecosystem. You will not find people to help you out. The collaboration between companies are completely missing. There are information availability, even if the government sources is missing. So you would actually have to keep a lot of focus on operations to build your product during these early consumer industry stages. Then last comes sales. Sales is very, very tricky. Sales is super tricky in scaling because there are ethical challenges, because the way you are designed and the way the sales guys are designed is absolutely different, right? What we would, at least what we used to think, was sales guys are like these supermans who can go and sell anything, right? That's most people's perception, saying that they are experts at sales, they should be able to sell anything. What my learning has been, they are able to sell things which are already sellable. So if you give a sales guy something that is already sellable, is the only time he actually can sell, and that's the only way you can actually increase scale. So when you have a problem that you do not have enough people talking to enough people so that your product can be sold, is when you can actually scale your sales. Else otherwise, even if you scale the team, your costs are going to get doubled, your operational headache is going to kill you, and just trying to keep the HR issues in check and the customer issues in check will keep you so busy that you will forget what the hell are you doing with your company in the first place. So sales is a very, very tricky space to scale. And since most of the time these guys are on field, and you really don't know what the hell is happening. So that's where I will talk about how you go about trying to do some of these things right. So one, in the first important space, as I said, self, the how you go about is try to find a mentor if possible. Unfortunately, in the last year of mushrooming internet industry and the startups being the new Bollywood, you will find mentor for everything, right? And which way, and unfortunately, most of those guys have never seen the scale, have never done a startup, and have no freaking clue what the hell they are talking about. So that has become another different set of problem. When we started, the problem was finding a guy, someone who could actually guide us. And people are not very interested in trying to help a 20-something old guy who's stupid enough to start. Unfortunately, the things have reversed this time. Now the problem is there are just too many knowledgeable people who think they are knowledgeable. So getting the person, and a lot of people are not able to differentiate between an advisor, a mentor, and a coach. There are different things that you require. So you will require personal help in specific areas. Let's say it could be public speaking, it could be writing great emails, it could be probably for me making good PPTs. So that is probably a coaching that you require, right? You would require a mentor who could also give you some personal strength, because entrepreneurship actually is a very, very challenging roller coaster that you are on a daily basis. Your day starts that I'm going to do so much today, and I'm going to win 3 more customers By the time you reach the office, you have these many emails and four employees standing outside your cabin complaining about something that has broken down. And by the time you sort those things out, it's already end of the day. And there is an investor pressure on top of your head that this number has missed. Can you just do a recalculation and send me a sheet? So really, really difficult, painful times. That's when you really need a mentor or a friend that you can talk to, an advisor, a sounding board where you can go and advisor generally is also a guy who actually asks you the right questions. So these three are different set of people. Unfortunately, in our ecosystem today, all of them are jumbled up and it's very difficult to find the right person for the right thing or having the right expectation in the first place. So if you go to a really brilliant guy and have a wrong expectation of him, you are also going to fail. So how do you go about scaling? What we did? So we first invested in some of the processes. And again, we did not do it upfront. I'm saying because we made the mistakes, the next time we decided to scale something, that's when we invested in the processes. The first time we screwed it up big time. Right? Everything was on Excel. The Excel was probably shared, in certain cases not shared. And the process was not documented. It was just poorly communicated across to the people. Every goddamn thing that could go wrong used to go wrong. Right? No one knew exactly what was committed to the customer at certain times, or the customer has already expired, you are still delivering leads to that guy. Right? So the processes became very, very critical. You have to invest in a process. And you will find, and my personal learning is, to do all of this, right, the people part becomes very, very important, very, very important. And you will find that different people suit different needs. There are people who can be very excited about that particular part. Those are the good people to hire. So in the process specifically, you need someone who's super disciplined, right? Who doesn't like things out of the standard procedure. He wants to come into the office in the morning, look at the particular Excel, look at the particular numbers in a particular way. If someone has not put it at the particular time, he'll call them and be rigorously disciplined about keeping process in check. And every time there is some exception that is required, which will be required on a daily basis, he will come to you and get that exception. So that way, although you are making an exception on a daily basis, but everything else is in control. So process becomes very, very critical to actually scaling. If you do not have processes in place, specifically for someone like us, Common Floor, we went from 3 people to 1300 plus people across 15 plus locations in the country. Everything went crazy. Specifically for the offices that you are not even sitting on, right? It is very, very difficult to really run. Right? And getting people to do what exactly you want to do becomes n times more harder, specifically if you are remotely located. Now coming to the people problem. Everyone tells you, okay, do this about HR, do this about people. You should not make a hiring mistake, hire for attitude, not for skill. But I can guarantee you will make all mistakes that are written in the people book. 120%. We made all of them plus some more of our own. So it is impossible not to make mistakes here. How can you reduce the instances of mistakes is what you should be actually focusing on. Because people problem is not straightforward logical problem that you give him a complete question paper, 2 plus 2 equals to 4, then it is right. That's not how it works. You will always be pressed for time and you will need someone who has already been done, who has already done that. Should I hire him for the skill? Yes, 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 yes. I need him yesterday kind of scenario. Everyone does that. But hiring was one area where we made a lot of initial mistakes, but we improved very, very drastically. I can proudly say Common Floor had the best team in the country on product and technology and execution, hands down. We had amazing processes in place to hire people. We had specific set of questions. So over the iterations, we realized there are two or three different things that you need to do specifically for the people problem. One is first document very clearly and articulate what is your vision, mission of the company. So why you exist? So basically your sales pitch to good people. At the end of the day, when you are hiring, you are trying to sell yourself to someone who can actually take you to where exactly you promise him that the company will go. So you're promising, actually going and promising him, this is where we're going to go, but this is the exact guy who can take you there. So getting that right is very, very important. We realized if we did not have a great pitch, right? And this great pitch was also held with some of the PR, what the industry thinks, because most people are going to talk to their peers before they try to join you. No matter what you are trying to say about yourself, you have to ensure that you have been able to create a good image in the industry about your technology. If it's very easily visible on your product that is broken, right? It's better you upfront accept that you have not yet completely fixed and you are on your path to becoming the best and not the best yet. A lot of people will claim in their entire this, I'm already the best, we have the best, and this guy will say, sorry, your login page does not have HTTPS. And they are scratching their head. So getting your hiring pitch right, then having a process in place, which is also a little time defined, getting the JD right. One of the difficult things that we felt specifically as a startup was getting a JD right. Because most of the time we just have got a rough idea what this guy is going to do. So getting the JD right became difficult. And that's where another opportunity is there, because you don't really know exactly what you want him to do. You actually hire more focus on the attitude. So that actually worked in our favor in many of the cases, because we said, Kibos, we don't know exactly what is going to be. We think these are the things that you will be doing, right? And then we evaluated on him on how quirky this guy was, what he has done, what kind of random things he has handled. And just because we took him on that role, a lot of those guys went about doing multiple things in the organization, scaling from one department to another, and learning on the go and building really rock solid teams. So it really helped us from that perspective. And then getting a panel of diverse set of people who can actually interview and get these guys in. And getting it early on is very, very important, because else otherwise you have made so many mistakes. Getting the panel right itself will become a challenge. So getting the people, you have to invest, and you have to actually, in our case, a lot of the people had never taken. So we had some people who were fresh out of college, but did a phenomenal kind of job, had no formal understanding of how to take interviews, what kind of processes. You have to invest in people's training and learning about all of these things. Again, investing in self, I already explained you. Get yourself mentor, advisor, coach, depending on where do you want to improve. Read a lot of things. Talk to a lot of your peers. Learn as much as possible about different business nitty-gritties that are happening across various different businesses in the industry. Training became very, very critical, specifically when we started to scale. We had to have a proper training book. Videos are very helpful. If you can have a platform which can actually deliver self-training across various locations, that really helps. Then you have a standardized training module everywhere. Without training, specifically as you start hiring operations and sales guys, it becomes a nightmare, because they are going to go and talk about something that you don't even have in your company as yet, right? So we have seen someone going and saying, sir, ye bhi bikta hai. So one customer said, ye jo logo hai na, yahan pe banner laga do. Haan sir, lag jayega. So he was ready to sell the space where the company's logo is. So anything can go wrong. Getting your training processes, evaluation methods is very, very important in place. And specifically in our case, since we are growing like crazy, we went from 80 to about 600 in less than 1 year, right? Training these guys who are there, those 80 people, to be able to handle and grow to the next level and be able to get the new guys trained really well about the culture, etc., and culture breaks down very, very quickly, was very, very big challenge. So again, we had to do, it took us about a couple of years to realign everyone back to the same culture that we were a part of. But the early guys also need to be trained to be able to, because these guys are mostly self-performers, self-driven, etc. They are not very great at being a manager. So these guys need to be trained to be able to help the new guys that are coming in. And it is not very obvious for us. It's not really obvious saying, okay, these guys already know, he will just tell the other guy. But there are softer aspects of the skills, right, which is like about evaluation, probably an emotional connect with the the juniors that are going to join him, which is completely missing in these really superstars of your organization. Technology for self and company use is also a very, very important aspect which Indians do not really value very much. Unfortunately, we are, as Daniel was saying, okay, we do not invest into, so probably a SaaS company serving a SaaS business is not really a great idea. In B2B, SaaS company is not a great idea. Because a lot of us try to cut corner and cut costs there, which is not the greatest thing. Having internal tools for your employees is most important, specifically when you're trying to scale. So if you're going to try to scale hiring and increase people, you need HR tools in place. So people can communicate, get up-to-date policies, everything in place quickly. Even if you need to pay some amount for it, please do. Have a proper HR portal for your employees if you're planning to scale, specifically if you are 50 plus employees at any point of time. You have to have internal tools to be able to give data understanding to your people, right? Most of the times, companies fly blind or have some one or two data points which are coming from the top on which they are running it. But having the tools to be able to see some data directly by the operational teams, the technology teams, etc., is very, very crucial. While we are trying, in fact, while we are trying having this product and technology roadmap, most of us do not consider time for building some things to make our operations easier, building something to make our servers more reliable, which is very, very crucial, specifically if you are going to scale. For us, we invested pretty decent amount of time and money in the internal tools which either were available through companies which are not in India or companies in India. But this technology for, and in fact for self-use also, right? Take premium LinkedIn subscriptions for your self-use. Get connected by email to every influencer that you want to talk to. Do not shy away from spending on the right technology which can save you time. So that is very, very critical when you are trying to scale, because a lot of people spend a lot more time trying to find ways around it, etc., or just trying to serve here now without realizing what they are losing. And overall, we invested in building the ecosystem. We tried, we had programs for brokers, we had programs for our associations, we have a book for how do you run an apartment association, we had webinars, we went to communities, did events in association with civic agencies to enlighten and build an ecosystem together. On the technology side, we had our developers go out, train people. We were the first one, and in fact, the largest in VR, the virtual reality Retina device that we made. We trained out, went to Google events, told how you can implement VR. So it is very helpful when you are actually giving back to the ecosystem. Your own employees also start feeling a very a good feeling of pride and belonging to the organization. And when you talk to your customers, sit across with them and share a knowledge session which is useful to the customer, they feel you are also a part of the problem solution that they are in. So overall, building an ecosystem is very, very important if you actually are looking to build a long-term, sustainable, large organization and company. With this, I would conclude. I would like to open the floor for the questions.
Thank you, Vikas. That was phenomenal. Any questions? Otherwise, we can do this over coffee. So, yep.
See, the trigger of the sale, I would not really say it was, we look at more as an merger. So if you look at the different advantages, so Common Floor already has the best domain expertise in this domain, right? But building a brand in India, pan India, specifically, see, anywhere which has educated large internet audiences, majorly in the southern region, we are clearly a dominant player. But across the country, and India is a very diverse country, brand is very, very important. If we have to redo building a brand, it would take us a lot longer time and cost us about probably 100 to 200 million to just get a couple of cities up. Whereas Quikr has the brand presence, so they have the width, we have the depth. They have the traffic, about 32 million visitors a month, right? The crazy about nearly, we say about 10% of internet visitors visits us in a monthly basis. So it made from here to here journey from here to here only. So it made a lot of sense to come together, because they were building this vertical, which they would have otherwise had to spend a lot of time and effort and energy. And for us, we needed the brand and the traffic. So we came together, it made a lot of sense. We had some common investors. So everyone thought it makes sense to actually run faster, and instead of competing against each other, probably compete against the market. And also, the market hasn't come up that very fast. Last 1.5 years, if you actually see, real estate has actually been in slump. Online real estate, after about over $100 million spent last year by the companies, they do not budge a lot more. So we think market will take time. So it was a very great time to build on your strength and move to the next level before the market again open up.
So that was the second question. In a market that's slumped, how does a startup react?
Market slump.
I mean, in a market that's down,
yes.
What do you do? I mean, you can't focus on growing the market.
See, specifically, when we started in 2007-8, when actually there the worst recession in our known history, at least in our lifetime, had hit the overall markets, and the sentiment was very, very bad. It's a very great time to actually start. You actually start focusing on. So last year, for example, we knew something like this could happen. We invested very heavily in building products. Today, we have one of the world's best suite of products for real estate industry. We are honing that. While the industry is suffering from southern side setbacks, they cannot run away from increasing efficiency. So we have products which are helping them increase the efficiency. So during the lean period of market, you build customer base really strong. You build your product really strong. You actually look at very critically on the fluff in your organization and try to lean down yourself. So it's a very good opportunity for you to become leaner, faster, meaner, and go like an arrow as soon as the market opens up. So that is the really great opportunity at this point of time for us. Cool. Anyone else?
Congratulations, Vikas, for becoming the trendsetter of the industry.
Thank you very much.
Like we discussed about, like how you scaled up from 30 to 1300 people. It's like my question is just about, like, what was the key challenges you faced for, like, keeping the founding team or the initial people in the loop or taking it to the next level? Because like,
so I think we've been very fortunate. Since it was, startup was not really cool to do. It was a stupid idea. Really, no one wanted to join a startup back then, right? The people that we brought on board initially, right, were friends and family kind of people. We lived together. We were very malleable. We could change into any roles, etc. And everyone was very, very focused on the value that we were providing to the end consumer. So the whole ethos and the value system of everyone in the core team was exactly same. So that, and none of us were purely driven by money. Because when we actually, you have to understand, when we got into this, everyone knew no one is going to make money. At least in the near foresight, there was no visibility to that. So everyone had very strong value system in place. That's why I was saying the hiring pitch, vision, mission, value system is very, very important. So our entire core team stuck for last 7-8 years. Everyone who was part of the team stuck.
But did things change when money comes in?
Not much. If you have worked through a hard times together, right, and you know each other so very well, you will have disagreements. It's great to have disagreements. In fact, you should not have people having the same mentality within the entire team. If you are agreeing on everything, probably you are going to fail faster. Because if you have different perspectives in the room, you should have that agreement to agree to disagree. But once you commit, you move in the same direction.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.